I'm in the right place, the wrong time. That's how I feel every day.
If you look at Jack White's career in music, common threads can be found weaved through the strangeness and genius of the man. At the dawn of the internet age, Jack was a man from another era. He badmouthed modern technology while thriving under purposeful limitation. He made music that was a tribute to blues music of the past, but he went about it in an artificial way through branding and myth-making. It all stemmed from a life-changing epiphany at the age of 15 that would guide Jack's life in more than just his music. And if you look back at the history of the White Stripes, there's one song in particular that could really sum up the band. It's off their 2003 record Elephant, it's Ball and Biscuit. It was April of 2002, and Jack and Meg White were now trying to record a follow-up to an album that gave them their first taste of mainstream success in White Blood Cells. For 2 weeks, in a little place called Toerag Studios in Hackney, London, England, they jammed, wrote, and recorded what would eventually be their biggest album of their career, Elephant. For inspiration, Jack stuck to the band's simple formula and the constricting elements he loved and knew. Blues music, minimalism, and the number 3. There was one song in particular that exemplified all of those ingredients the most.
It's quite possible that I'm your third man, girl. But it's a fact that I'm the seventh son.
The number 3 goes back to Jack's days as a young teenager. There was one day in his native Detroit, Michigan, where a young 15-year-old Jack White was routinely cleaning up the upholstery shop he just started apprenticing at. Suddenly, a couch that was being worked on caught his eye. It had 3 staples tamping the fabric down, left, right, and center, and he just stared at it for 10 minutes. It became hypnotic. A light bulb went off in Jack's head, and it had to do with the mystical properties of the number 3 and what it represented. This was the minimum amount of staples needed to hold this fabric down. The number 3 exemplifies a perfection that cannot be obtained. A table has to have 3 legs or else it falls down. In an interview with Conan O'Brien, Jack explained that it's a concept of minimalism and looking at it as not anything more than what you absolutely need.
I think about that probably once a week, that image of that, those 3 staples, and it's affected everything. I force myself to do anything that I create artistically, music-wise, whatever it is. I force it through the funnel of that idea, you know, and I have 3 lines or 3 concepts in a song, or I wrap it around storytelling, melody, and rhythm. The White Stripes, the whole band was based on the number 3.
The number 3 is plastered all over Ball and Biscuit. It's arguably the bluesiest song the White Stripes ever recorded, and what's the 12-bar blues framed by? 3 chords, the 1, 4, and 5, aka the tonic, subdominant, and dominant. Although it's the longest song the band ever recorded at just over 7 minutes, Jack only uses 3 chords. The number 3 has an influence on the White Stripes as early as their first single they put out on their first album, The Big 3 Killed My Baby.
The Big 3 Killed My Baby!
The number 3 is used as a color code with the White Stripes, red, white, and black, and just as a band as a whole, they represent rock stripped down to its most basic 3 parts, melody, rhythm, and lyrics, or its 3 most essential instruments, a guitar, a simple drum kit, and vocals. The next phrase in Ball and Biscuit reflects Jack's love of the blues. It represents the character trying to impress a girl with his claim to be a seventh son. It's a reference to a Chicago blues song from Willie Dixon titled The Seventh Son.
Everybody crying about the seventh son, but...
stemming from old blues folklore that the seventh son of a seventh son would be granted supernatural powers. On Ball and Biscuit, there's no keyboards. There's no orchestra, no massive vocal harmonies. It's just the disciplined sound of the White Stripes, simple thudding drums, Jack's spoken word delivery, and the testing of amp violence with blazing guitar solos. In any of Jack's creative outputs, he's looking at it as being liberated by limiting himself. It's almost like he's tricking his brain. There's no paralysis by being overwhelmed with options.
I like to be boxed in. I like to, the band is a box, you know. I have to fight out of all the time. We've purposely constricted ourselves and kept ourselves from expanding, you know. Always about constriction with this band. And that helps me create. It helps when I'm forced to do that. I create better, I think.
Jack is a modest man in real life, but gets out his anger and emotion in his songwriting. It's therapeutic to let out that frustration and to sing about the extremes of life. And that's where you get the chorus of Ball and Biscuit about a drug-riddled night with a girl.
Oh, let's have a ball and a biscuit, sugar.
Ball and a biscuit could refer to doing drugs, ball being a speedball or cocaine, while the biscuit referring to quaaludes or ecstasy. You get drug references in the chorus, as well as a general cockiness and sexiness oozing throughout the track. Ball and Biscuit was never released as a single, but it became a concert staple for the band and is a fan favorite to this day. In that 7 minutes plus track, it encapsulates the White Stripes as a band. It's not necessarily about the lyrics, but the emotion everything put together invokes. It's based in blues and painted over with a garage rock brush. It's pushing Jack and Meg to their artistic limits, and it's forced through the purposeful limitation of the number three.